This time, please welcome Mr. Brian Albert.
Thank you. First off, congratulations to all of you on graduating and taking advantage of an opportunity that most of your peers did not here at Smith Career and Technology Center. It just so happens that about 2 weeks ago, I was ushered off by the faculty and staff at Virginia Tech as I completed an engineering degree and headed off to Charlotte, North Carolina, as Mr. McKinney was saying, to work for Bank of America. But it was 4 years ago that I was an eager drafting student, sitting in the same exact seats that you are today, that I began to realize the opportunity that was given to me, the same opportunity that has been given to you. But first, no graduation speech would be complete without a list of top fives. First, we'll start with a quote by Mark Twain, who once wrote, "When I was a boy of 14, my parents were so ignorant that I could hardly stand to have them around. But when I got to be 21, I was astonished at how much those old folks had learned in just 7 years." Number four, "It is indeed ironic that we spend our school days yearning to graduate and our remaining days reminiscing about our school days." Number three, "A graduation ceremony is an event where the commencement speaker tells thousands of students dressed in identical caps and gowns that individuality is the key to success." Number two, graduation speeches were invented largely in belief that outgoing students should never be released into the real world until they have properly been lectured to sleep. So we'll give you the last one a little bit later, but first, now I hope that you will have patience and listen as I attempt to put you to sleep with some words about opportunism. So what is opportunism? To portray this idea, I'd first like to share with you two stories. The first one was told by Dr. Torgerson, who was the former Virginia Tech president, as he taught a class my senior year last semester. And it's about a guy named Carter Burgess, who joined the military police after graduating from Virginia's VMI, Virginia Military Institute. He was given some crummy orders to serve on the night shift by watching some bridge and reservoir located near Washington, D.C. Exhausted and tired after finishing the night shift, while walking through the security gate, his commanding officer pulled him to the side and said, "I know you're tired and you can say no, but would you mind pulling an extra shift as a security guard for a group of British ambassadors at the White House?" It would have been easy for Carter Burgess to say no, but he saw this as an opportunity and accepted the proposal. During the ambassador's meeting, he made friends with some of the British ambassadors and also an unknown one-star general at the time named Dwight Eisenhower. Eisenhower then requested after that day, that Carter Burgess be his personal assistant as he traveled overseas to fight the war. After Eisenhower was promoted to a five-star general status and given the title Supreme Commander of the European Allied Forces during World War II, General Eisenhower told Burgess, "I'm sorry, but I can't have someone with the meager rank of officer as my personal assistant. Therefore, I'm going to have to promote you." So he became lieutenant. And through the series of several more rapid promotions, Carter Burgess eventually became a colonel, which is just one rank below one-star general. The rest of Carter Burgess's story goes something like this. In his 30s, he was president of Trans World Airlines. In his 40s, he was president of the American Machine and Foundry, now AMF. In his 50s, he served as a U.S. ambassador to Argentina. And while Carter Burgess was still serving Eisenhower as his personal assistant during the war, he made a trip back to his original base in Washington, D.C. to pay a visit to his old commanding officer. Now outranking him, Carter told his boss the story of his success and asked his former boss, "What was it that you saw in me that persuaded you to ask me to go to that White House meeting that night at the gate?" He replied, "My commanding officer told me to grab the next guy that walked through the gate, and you were the first one I saw." That is opportunism. Taking advantage of a one-time offer, a stroke of luck that could change your life. So why is opportunism important? Well, in the last lecture of a well-respected professor at Virginia Tech, he said, "There is someone else around the world who is willing to do your job twice as good as you can for half the amount of money. The difference between your success and theirs is your opportunities." Opportunism can be summarized in a three-step plan. Recognize an opportunity. If needed, ignore your plans and then seize the opportunity. And now, a potentially less interesting story that I hope is still relevant. My experience at Smith Career and Technology Center and how it helped me to get to where I am today. I moved to Marion at the beginning of my junior year in high school, was recommended to take drafting here by Marion's guidance counselor. On the last day of school, after having taken drafting of my junior year, my drafting teacher, Mr. Sturgill, contacted me about a summer job opportunity with a local architecture firm named Spectrum Design. I worked there and gained a ton of experience with AutoCAD, which is a computer-aided layout tool for making drawings. And then, during my senior year, I completed drawings for the Marion Senior High's Driver's Ed parking lot. Because of some of the recommendations that I received for my work on doing this, I ended up receiving the Robert C. Byrd Scholarship, which was a substantial amount of money that helped me to get through college. Then, after working 3 summers at Spectrum Design, the architecture firm, I started to look for engineering-related internships. Several years prior, in an emergency situation, I helped a relative of a future member of our church move some hay between some barns. As a token of his gratitude, this man went the extra mile networking with managers at local manufacturing plants to help me get an interview. After getting the interview, Merrillat cited that one of their primary reasons for hiring me was because of my AutoCAD experience, which I'd learned here at Smith Career and Technology Center. Because of the experience with manufacturing techniques that I gained while at Merrillat, top recruiters began to call me up during my senior year asking if I would like to interview with them. And one final life lesson, while at a final round of interviews with Bank of America, who I'm now working for in Charlotte, I ran into an old high school classmate from yearbook class who was helping with the interview process. This was somebody from Salem before I came here. The way in which I had treated this person over 7 years ago, which was the last time I had seen him, would determine whether or not I would get that job. All of my future jobs spawned from the experience I gained while here at Smith Career and Technology Center. So go tell your friends and sign up. Because I took advantage of a drafting class offered to me, I got a summer architecture job. Because I helped volunteer to bale hay one evening, a man went the extra mile to help me out to get an interview. And because I had the computer aid drafting here with art and also got more experience with the architecture firm, I got an engineering-related internship. And because of the practical skills I learned in manufacturing, I received the opportunity that led to my next job working at Bank of America. And then it just so happens that the very first project they assigned me to is once again AutoCAD layouts with Bank of America. And the opportunity that my drafting education and what I had learned here provided me with some of the most vital contributions to my job success. And finally, I'll share with you my final quote. Graduates, your families are extremely proud of you. You can't imagine the sense of relief they are experiencing. This would be a most opportune time to ask for money. I wish you the best of luck and God bless.